Thank you for coming. The CFA colloquium today is being given by Professor Lyndsay Flectcher. Lyndsay did her undergraduate and PhD at the University of Glasgow in Scotland. She then did postdoctoral work in the Netherlands, both at Utrecht and at the European Space Agency in Leiden. She traveled to the US to work at the Lockheed Solar Physics Group, collaborators of us over many decades now, and then returned to Glasgow, where she is now a full professor of astrophysics. Lyndsay's interests are in solar physics, in the acceleration of particles by magnetic fields and waves in the solar atmosphere. She is the geophysics secretary for the Royal Astronomical Society, and she was very recently appointed as a fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. Is that correct? Yes, that's the right title? Right title. That one. The important one. So, and her talk today is on solar flares, how the sun relaxes, and I will turn it over to you. Thank you, Lynn.
Thank you very much, Ed. Thank you, and thank you. Thank you for inviting me here for this colloquium. It's a great pleasure to visit the CFA, somewhere I've always wanted to come, and I don't know how I got so far into my career without being here before. So anyway, yes, what I'm going to talk about is the solar flares, how the sun relaxes. Maybe I should more correctly say how the solar corona relaxes, because this is really all to do with events taking place in the outer magnetized solar atmosphere of the sun. Let me start off, as is traditional in solar physics talks, with a beautiful movie, the like of which you can't unfortunately get yet in nighttime astronomy. This is a composite movie showing the extreme ultraviolet corona on the outside here with Solar Dynamics Observatory. What we're seeing here is plasma at a temperature of around 1,000,000 Kelvin. And then an inset is the ultraviolet lower atmosphere taken with the IRIS spacecraft. This is the slit jaw camera. And what we're looking at is the development of a fairly major flare, a so-called X-class flare. And there are, you know, there are many things that you can learn just by looking here. You can see that there's action taking place in the lower atmosphere. You get these very kind of elongated, finely structured patches in the lower solar atmosphere, which we call flare ribbons. The flare ribbons, there are two of them generally, and one on either side of what's called the polarity inversion line. There's a big sunspot here, there's a more diffuse kind of sunspot group on that side, and here are the ribbons, one here and one there, actually marching into the core of the sunspot where the field is strong. The field is 2-3 kilogauss maybe, and so this is a process which is connected to the very strongest magnetic fields on the sun. But then also if you look at the more tenuous outer part of the corona, you can see that these magnetic arches or loops, they react to the flare, and they react with a kind of shrinking, a so-called implosion of the fields, which I'll talk about as we go along. But also you'll see earlier on something propagating outwards, and we believe that this is the blast wave associated with a coronal mass ejection. Let's just see that loop shrinkage here. You can see the blast wave going out there. And this is all pretty much simultaneous. The strong radiation sources which take place in the chromosphere, the contraction of the field and the blast wave are all happening very closely associated in time, and all to do with the conversion of magnetic energy into other forms, ultimately into the radiation that we see. In the gradual phase of the flare, which is this part here, you get these very bright, in fact, overexposed loops, which are full of hot plasma, which has been basically driven up in a process that we misname chromospheric evaporation. It's not chromosphere, it's not evaporation at all, it's expansion of the lower atmosphere into the corona. Okay, so that's a lot of the kind of the phenomenology of a flare, and I'll be addressing different parts of that as we go along. Just as a quick overview of what I'm going to talk about, there'll be an introductory section with some motivation for what we're looking at and also some basic observations. I'll talk about the storage and release of energy in flares, and I'll talk about how the energy is moved through the atmosphere and how it is dissipated. And particularly, I'm going to talk about this idea, competition, if you like, between whether the energy is carried by beams of particles or whether the energy is carried by magnetic waves. And this is a fairly robust debate at the moment. Talk about how these things can be tested with a combination of simulations and observations. And then I'll say a little bit about super flares and stellar flares, because, you know, the sun, of course, is our touchstone for a lot of magnetic activity on stars. And if stellar physicists think that we understand what's going on in solar flares, I'm afraid they are sadly misled, because we don't. Why do we look at flares? Well, each of these three, I think, is equally important, but why I look at flares is this: it's the plasma physics, the basic plasma physics. As an undergraduate, the two courses I liked most were stellar physics and plasma physics, and the two come together in solar flares. The properties of magnetized plasmas, how you store energy, how you convert energy, how the energy is manifested in different forms in a magnetized plasma. But then, of course, in astrophysics, most of the luminous universe is a plasma, and plasmas in motion generate magnetic fields, and that also has an energy storage and release aspect to it as well. So I think that, you know, it's a line which the solar astronomers sell all the time when they're trying to get their grants funded. The sun is the touchstone for astrophysical plasmas, but there is some truth to that. We can start to dig inside the physics, which may be happening in different parts of the universe. And then there's also the practical side, if you like. This is what we tell governments to try and get funding for: space weather, the effect on planets, the link to coronal mass ejections and enhanced shortwave radiation flux, and all of the influences that has on the world that we live in. But the questions that I'm going to concentrate on here is where the energy for the flare comes from, how it was stored, why it's released, how it's transported, and how it's dissipated. It's the chain of energy moving through the atmosphere that I think is one of the most interesting things you can look at. I will take a little, in going through an introduction to the observations, let me go back a step. Now, many people probably know about this event. This is the Carrington flare, 1859. The first recorded flare observation, and probably also the largest flare that has ever been detected during the time when people were looking at the sun. This was observed by Richard Carrington, who was an independently wealthy astronomer. Wouldn't that be fun? He was son of a brewing company, which still exists, Carrington Breweries, but he didn't, for some reason, want to continue brewing beer. He wanted to be an astronomer. I've known people who actually go in the other direction. He wanted to be an astronomer, and he had a private observatory at Red Hill in Surrey, and he would go out every day and draw the sunspot groups. And this was a particular sunspot group which had excited a lot of attention because it was so large. It was a huge group, and so he was out drawing it one day when he saw... he witnessed an unusual phenomenon. You should go and look at this paper, Carrington, 1859, where it describes it, because it's written in a kind of English that you don't see in the astrophysical journal anymore. So he was engaged one forenoon in his usual activities of drawing the positions and sizes of the largest spots on the solar disk, blah, blah, blah. And suddenly he witnessed this thing. In these four locations, A, B, C, and D, I'll just fill them in red, he saw bright flashes of emission. Ran off to get his assistant, because this was drawn, you know, there was no photography applied to astronomy at that time. Ran off to get his assistant, but when his assistant legged it back with him, unfortunately, the phenomenon was sadly diminished. However, this was independently observed by another observer, Hodgson, and the two papers are back-to-back in the monthly notices at that time. The colour was likened to the star Alpha Lyrae. Bluish-white colour and very brilliant. Meanwhile, the magnetometer at Kew Gardens was recording Kew Gardens in London. There's three panels here: west declination, horizontal force, and vertical force. It's basically the three components of the magnetic field on 3 days, August 30th, August 31st, September 1st. Now, September 1st was the time of the flare, and you see here what's called an ionospheric crotchet there, here, and here. And that is the process that happens when the ultraviolet radiation, the prompt radiation from the flare, increases the ionization in our ionosphere. So you get transient currents which flow, which makes a transient component of the magnetic field. And that transient component of the magnetic field is detected on Earth as a little twitch in the magnetometer data. And then a day and a half later, that happens and the magnetometers go off the scale, and that's the coronal mass ejection arriving and really disturbing the magnetic field. And this particular event was aurora were seen in California and in Hawaii, and it was a really spectacular event. And this is what we frighten governments with, the Carrington flare, because it is predicted that if this were to happen now, when we are so reliant on long conduction lines and satellites in space and so on, then this could really be very destructive. So some more modern observations. A flare is basically a multi-wavelength phenomenon. There is no part of the electromagnetic spectrum that a flare does not emit in. We see it in the radio, though I don't have any radio here. We see it in long and short wavelength radio. We see it in the ultraviolet, the extreme ultraviolet, the optical, hard X-rays, soft X-rays. Any way that the plasma can radiate to get rid of the energy which has been dumped into it, it will radiate. Now, what's the most unimpressive picture here? It's probably that one, okay? This is a magnetogram in the background. No, it's not a magnetogram, I'm sorry, I beg your pardon. This is just a white light image. And so we see a complicated spot group here, and these are ribbons in the optical. The optical part of the spectrum is where the majority of the energy of a flare is radiated. You wouldn't know it to look at it. It looks very, very unimpressive. I mean, the drama is all of this stuff, but the important radiation is in the optical part of the spectrum. But by putting together all of these different wavelengths, we can start to build a picture of the energy content, if you like, of a flare. What's the big picture of energy flow in this? Well, it starts with the rotation and convection of the sun. You know, and the rotation of the sun is because it was rotating when it was formed, and the convection is because it's got a giant nuclear oven at the centre. The differential rotation and convection winds up the solar magnetic field, some of which becomes unstable and pops up through the atmosphere and gives you magnetic energy stored in the corona in regions like this. When the magnetic stresses get too much for the plasma to bear, for reasons that we don't really understand, but people like Kathy Reeves here are working on, a catastrophe happens in the solar corona. And that stored coronal magnetic energy is changed into other forms in a very dynamic way. We can do some rough energy budgets. So about 30 to 50% of the stored coronal magnetic energy goes directly into the kinetic energy of fast particles, electrons and ions. Of that kinetic energy, precisely 100%, no, actually, it's not true. I was going to say precisely 100%, but it's actually more like 99.9995% of it goes into radio to gamma ray radiation. What happens to the other 0.005% of it? Sometimes it excites sun quakes. It actually shakes the photosphere and you get helioseismically detected ripples going out across the surface of the sun. And that's a very interesting field of research right now. About 1 to 10% of the stored coronal energy is directly converted in the corona to radiant energy, predominantly in the extreme ultraviolet and X-ray part of the spectrum. And the other roughly 50% of the energy goes into the mass motion of a coronal mass ejection. So if you were to just give rough numbers, it's about 50% going into fast particles, 50% going into mass motion. But all the energy that goes into fast particles is primarily re-radiated in the forms that we see. So I mentioned that the radiant energy of a flare is basically optical, and that's very unfortunate because we barely observe in the optical part of the spectrum. This will change. The radiation from a flare comes primarily from the solar chromosphere, and this is a part of the atmosphere that nobody really wants to get their hands dirty with. It's just too complicated. Jean Everett is one of the very few brave people who will do that. Because you have to think about radiative transfer and who wants to do that, and atomic physics and, you know, thermodynamics and statistical equilibrium and ionization, all kinds of hideous things. But that's where the richness of the physics is, really. And this is where I think a lot of attention in the solar physics community overall, and also in the flare physics community, has been focusing is on the chromosphere. We need to understand this interface between the visible surface, the photosphere, and the tenuous atmosphere, the chromosphere. Things change. The tenuous atmosphere is the corona, and this changes across the chromosphere, which is a narrow layer, 2,000 or 3,000 kilometers thick. Temperature increases by a factor of 1,000, goes from basically neutral to basically ionized. The density changes by factors of 10^6. It's great fun. But that's where most of the radiation comes from, so we have to get to grips with it. The total flare radiant energy, as I mentioned, is rather poorly known. Typically, most of it emerges in the UV to optical and solar flares. That's temperature range, which can maybe characterise as 5,000 to 50,000 Kelvin. Solar flare optical spectroscopy is rare. This is going to change when the Daniel K. Inouye solar telescope sees first light in 2019. We will, apart from the fact that it's solar minimum in 2019, then there won't be many flares. If there are some active regions, then you can bet your bottom dollar that the DKIST will be looking at them, and we'll learn more about flare spectroscopy. However, we do have some direct measurements of the total flare radiated energy in very big flares. This is the direct sun as a star measurement of the power in an X flare. This is made by Tom Woods with his source satellite, which is to measure the TSI, the total solar irradiance. And this is a flare here. Now it's sitting on a background of P modes. This is all this noise is P mode noise. It's the solar oscillations leading to changes in the brightness. And, you know, there's a kind of trend, which is probably there was an active region going across the sun or something like that. But here's the flare. And so we know it's a flare because there was a big X-ray signature at that time. And so in this and a few other rare events, you can actually add up the energy and you get something like at the peak 10 to the 29 ergs per second being radiated, and that's about 10 to the 32 ergs total. What about the relationship with coronal mass ejections? Well, and it's a close one. Most of the X-class flares have, this is the sorry, let me step back. Flares are classified A, B, C, M, X. X is the biggest one, and then M, and then these are logarithmic classifications, and I don't know why it worked out that way. But this is basically X, M, C, B, I think is the range. And so the X-class flares, basically 100% of them, well, 90% here, have a coronal mass ejection. And this is just a still of a coronal mass ejection, and it's a very extended thing. Here's the disk of the sun. This is a coronagraph image, and in here is it's called the difference image. We're actually looking at the difference between two frames. Now, you probably can't see, but in the middle here, right about where my pointer is and about the size of my pointer, there's a tiny red and a tiny blue dot, and that is the X-ray signature from the flare. So the flare is very compact, and the coronal mass ejection is very large. The flare energy density, they're about 50-50, as we saw before. Flare energy density is therefore very much bigger than the energy density in the coronal mass ejection. So you're taking a lot of energy and you're dumping it in a very small volume. So you maybe shouldn't be too surprised that non-thermal particles result, because it's one of the few things that the plasma can do to get rid of that energy, is make non-thermals. The acceleration of the coronal mass ejection peaks simultaneously with hard X-rays. So the red here is hard X-rays, so that is prompt bremsstrahlung radiation from accelerated electrons which are stopping collisionally in a dense target, the chromosphere, we think. And it's up and down like this. And then here is the you know, you should never differentiate data, and you certainly should never take the double differential of data, but this here is the double differential of the data, using a very smart regularization technique to ensure smoothness and things like that. And basically, the acceleration of the coronal mass ejection and the hard X-rays are simultaneous to within the observational precision that we have. So you have a picture here of the whole corona reacting very rapidly and very directly to a reconfiguration of the magnetic field. What about magnetic energy storage? Well, we have all kinds of tricks that we use, and this is also being done, of course, in stellar physics, although not with such spatial resolution. This is a magnetic field map, and red and blue are positive, negative and positive fields, and you can see there's lots of little arrows over this. So we have the line of sight field, and we also have the in the plane component. So we have three components of the magnetic field at the level of the photosphere. And we can, using div B is zero and this thing curl B is alpha B, which is called the force free condition, basically tells you that the only forces that matter are the J cross B forces. You can compute. Yes, you can compute the magnetic field lines. Lines that visualize the magnetic field lines, I suppose. And you can, because curl of B is mu naught J, you can code them with color. And so you can see the current density in here is high, right between these two strong magnetic polarities. And there are other sort of high regions here, high current regions here. And so this tells us where the energy is stored. It's stored in between the strong polarities. And this work by Soon et al., great name for a solar physicist, this work by Soon et al. Also demonstrated that the storage of magnetic energy is low down in the atmosphere. The chromosphere is maybe 3,000 kilometres thick. This thing, which is called a flux rope, is sitting there about 5,000 kilometres. It's very low down. Everything is very compact and stressed between these two polarities here. And, you know, he identifies it with I find it hard to see myself, but a filament along here, a dark absorbing feature. So this is the kind of game we play. It's actually surprisingly difficult to do this robustly. You know, data gets in the way. It has all kinds of unwanted properties, ambiguities and noise and so on. But, you know, the game that a lot of solar physicists play is to try and understand the configuration of the coronal magnetic field and where the energy is being stored. Now, what about release, the release of the energy? There's a little bit of observational evidence for what actually happens to the field when that goes on. Typically, if you look at the photospheric magnetic field, you see abrupt changes in the photospheric magnetic field. This was a fairly controversial thing when Sudol and Harvey proposed it or made the first report of observations. That's not quite true. Cameron did it before, but people really listened to these guys, Sudol and Harvey. Because the idea prior to these unambiguous observations was that the field at the level of the photosphere was line-tied, and it couldn't do that, and it couldn't do that. It was absolutely fixed at the level of the photosphere, but it's not. So this is just one example. It happens to be the one that the flare, the activation which I showed before. And you can measure the total magnetic flux, and at the time of the flare, it increases, which to the solar physicist among you might sound a little odd, because a flare is the release of magnetic energy, so why is it increasing? Well, it's because the horizontal component is increasing because the field is collapsing. The field is shortening, the lines are shrinking, and the effect of that is to make the apparent magnitude of the horizontal component of the field increase. And this is the best interpretation that we have of this. So this is a kind of indication that the shortening of magnetic field lines and the associated change in the total magnetic energy associated with that shortening of the field lines is really the essence of the flare energy release. It's as simple as that. You can look at the vertical Lorentz force, and this is also work by Gordon Petrie, who's a fellow Scot, works at NSO, National Solar Observatory. And you can calculate from the Maxwell stress tensor, you can calculate the Lorentz force. And this is a downwards Lorentz force, so the change in the field exerts a force downwards on the chromosphere and on the photosphere at the same time. So this is all quite new stuff and quite exciting. So a flare is a magnetic convulsion, a giant magnetic convulsion. Another beautiful image here. And again, you can see some of those features that we spoke about before. You can see a shockwave propagating out. You can see these loops collapsing in. You can maybe just about, it's very overexposed, but there's some loops in the middle and ribbons and so on. So, you know, you can almost stop the talk there and say that a flare happens when the coronal magnetic field restructures and the rest of the atmosphere does what it has to do to get rid of that energy. We can hopefully be a bit more specific than that, though. One phenomenon, I'll just kind of sidetrack a little bit just to indicate something which you may have noticed. It's a little, maybe a little hard to see, but if you look at some of these loops, when they shrink in, they don't stay still. Some of them kind of wobble a little bit. If you look here, it's actually quite clear. They kind of oscillate. Now, this was seen for the first time in 1998 with the Trace satellite. This is the same event, but in just in one wave band, it's much less confusing. And here are some individual loops which are being tracked. This is work that my postdoc, Paulo Sumarez, did. Very nice paper on this. And you can make a cut along this direction here and stack everything up as time goes on. So this is the direction of the cut. And you can see this is a loop which is, well, first of all, there's a kind of expansion. The region swells up a little bit. And then a contraction. In some cases, there's a contraction followed by an oscillation. There's a very nice example here, the contraction followed by an oscillation. Now, we think that we understand how the contraction and the oscillation fit together. Basic idea is that before a flare, you've got a strongly magnetized something, flux rope filament, which is supporting an overlying loop. There's a magnetic pressure gradient, and then there's a magnetic tension force. Flare happens, and you eat up some of that magnetic free energy. And so you reduce the support. And the collapse of the loop restores the force balance, also shortens the loop, and releases some energy in the process. But then the loop will overshoot, or may overshoot, depending on its natural frequency, its natural timescale. And if it overshoots in the right way, then it will start to bounce off. If it oscillates down like this. And in fact, you can use that. This is a very nice piece of work which Alexander Russell from Dundee did. You can, with a simple mechanical model, you can use these oscillations to put some constraints on the timescale on which the energy is being released. And in fact, this one over here in the corner is the case that happens when the change in equilibrium is approximately equal to the oscillation timescale. And then you get this characteristic pattern where you see both the contraction and the oscillation together. And so you can look at the frequency of the oscillation and say, okay, the time scale on which the magnetic energy disappeared from the core of the system in here somewhere was on the order of 2 minutes or something like that. So it's quite a nice diagnostic there. And there's a clear relationship between this contraction process, this magnetic reconfiguration process, and the non-thermal particles that we see. So this was the inner loop, loop four in that movie, and its position is decreasing, its location is shrinking in. If you calculate the velocity, then you see a peak in the velocity just at the time when the hard X-rays, which is the black curve, is peaking. So the time when the velocity of the shrinking loop is highest is the time when the hard X-rays is peaking. So there's an intimate relationship between the global dynamics of the magnetic field in the corona and the fast electrons. What it is, who knows. So here's the cartoon of a flare, a standard model, a flare cartoon. You start off with stressed, unconnected fields. It's very hard to draw a stressed field in two dimensions because you really need to be able to put in twist and stretch, but take it from me, this is a stressed field. The magic process of magnetic reconnection happens. And the net effect of reconnection is to allow the field to reconfigure. It does also locally release some energy because you have a dissipation region. You have an X point or a current sheet or something like that. So in a small volume, you can release some energy. The size of that volume and the amount of energy released depends on a number of properties, but really, where the energy comes from is the fact that the field can then relax. After, these are relaxed field lines which have already undergone reconnection. Sorry, they're relaxing. They're shrinking. They may be also untwisting as well, because to store energy in a field, you have to twist it. And so to get, as well as stretch it and twist it. And so to get energy out, you let it shrink and untwist. And so there's probably shrinking happening. In other words, what you might call a slow mode wave, a slow mode magnetoacoustic wave, a disturbance propagating perpendicular to the field, and also an alphenic disturbance, a twisting or untwisting. And you get electrons accelerated up in the corona. We see hard X-rays in the corona. We see radio bursts from the corona. So there are certainly some electrons accelerated in connection with this process. Energy flows down the magnetic field, and we know that it flows down the field because we see the energy coming out in very localized patches, flare ribbons, and foot points. And we also see those progress as reconnection eats up more and more in fields, bringing it into the reconnection region here. And then at the bottom, you get the chromospheric foot points, which are basically everything, UV, optical emission, hard X-rays, gamma rays, everything else. And also, because there's hard X-rays, there must be fast electrons down there as well. And so that gives us a kind of general framework. Oops. There's also evaporation. There's plasma flows back up there and fills in the loop. Gives us a general framework to understand the configuration here. It's just a conceptual framework, a cartoon, if you like. But the question really, in my mind, is what's this? What's the energy flux? What's the energy flux? And there has been a long-standing model about this. Now, there are clear requirements. We know before a flare, energy is stored in the coronal field. During the flare, energy is radiated by the chromosphere, and so the energy has to get from the corona to the chromosphere. And it must happen rapidly. We can look at foot points in the hard X-rays, and they are, in many cases, synchronous to within maybe 0.1, 0.2 seconds. Some cases not, but in some cases they are. And so that means that, you know, the energy must, it must be synchronized, and that might mean that the energy flows rapidly and symmetrically down two parts of the magnetic field, or it starts here and it goes over there, but it has to be fast. It has to be going at, you know, 0.1, 0.3 times the speed of light, something like that. And the energy must also be strongly ducted along the magnetic field. So that rules out magnetoacoustic waves, which are not ducted along the magnetic field. You can have slow magnetoacoustic waves, you can have fast waves that are ducted, which go across the field, and slow waves which go along the field, but they're slow. They're not going fast enough. So you're only left really with two options. One is that there are fast beams of charged particles which spiral along the field, or there are alphane waves. And that's the only two options which are plausible. And it's this one which has held sway for, Brown 71, my old supervisor's thesis paper was, one of his thesis papers was about this. So really that's when it started to grab people's attention. And this is the upstart model. But let's look at the non-thermal electrons. Non-thermal electrons are important. I thought that would just play by itself. Up to 50% of the total magnetic energy is converted to the kinetic energy of non-thermal particles, and predominantly that's electrons. Those of you who were here at lunchtime will have seen me talk about our search for non-thermal ions. Very hard to find non-thermal ions, but electrons are easy. We can see them. We see images. Here's an X-ray movie. In the background is H-alpha. The grayscale is H-alpha. And then these blobs are Bremsstrahlung emission at 30 to 80 keV, so we're talking electrons at like 60 to 100, 150 keV. And then this big blobby thing in the middle is thermal X-ray emissions. It's much softer, probably just from plasma at about 20 million Kelvin. And here's a spectrum, and you can see this is from RESI. This is the background, just so you can see where the background is in comparison. And there's, we fit this with a thermal component and a non-thermal component. And from that, you can calculate all kinds of properties of the non-thermal electrons. And this is the model. There is a black box up here, and that's the corona, and it accelerates electrons. The non-thermal electron beam transport model assumes electrons are accelerated up here, and there's a an enormous amount of wonderful papers in going in enormous detail into all of the possible acceleration mechanisms you would care to think of happening up here in the corona. And then the electrons emerge from the accelerator and tied to the magnetic field, they in and of themselves transport the energy down to the chromosphere. They stop collisionally in the dense chromosphere and they heat it up and they also emit hard X-ray radiation. So there's a really nice picture where everything fits together, all linked around these electrons moving through the corona. And under those assumptions, specifically under the assumption that the electrons stop collisionally in the chromosphere and they just have one pass, so they start off fast and they end up slow, and nothing else happens in between apart from Coulomb collisions, you can determine the electron number flux from the Bremsstrahlung spectrum. And this is one of the wonderful things that RESI has allowed us to do. Unfortunately, when you do it, you find numbers that you don't really like. One of them is the total flux. 10 to the 35 to 10 to the 36 electrons per second must arrive from the corona and stop in the chromosphere. Now, the density of the corona is about 10 to the 9 per cubic centimetre, maybe even less in the core of active regions. And so that means you need maybe 10 to the 27 centimetres cubed, a volume of 10 to the 9 by 10 to the 9 by 10 to the 9, which is pretty much the corona above an active region. So what this tells you is that you have to empty all of the electrons in the corona during a flare in each second, get those electrons down into a few tiny foot points in the chromosphere, and then keep doing it for 15 minutes. And this is where it gets difficult. So, and it's worse. That's called the number problem. In principle, the number problem is solvable if you can keep resupplying the corona with electrons. And the phenomenon of the return current, has been invoked to do that. So this is a little bit more about the beam dynamics. So here's the standard model electron rate, 10 to the 35 to 10 to the 36 electrons leaving the corona. We can measure the area of the beam from hard X-rays, which is rather tricky. It must be done by an expert, and from the optical, which is not difficult. You can do it by counting pixels. And this is an image of, in the white contour in the background is a G-band image, which is the basically the carbon monoxide, no, no, CH is not carbon monoxide, it's the CH band head. It's basically optical, proxy for the optical. And on top of that is yellow contours for 25 to 100 keV. So this is really where the electrons are seen, where they're radiating, where the foot points of the flare are. And you can measure this, and it's about 10 to the 16 square centimetres. This is work done by Sam Crooker, I should say. That gives you the beam flux, 10 to the 19 to 10 to the 20 electrons per square centimetre per second. We know the beam speed because we know the energy, because they radiate these photons that we see at 30 keV. And so that tells you it's 1 to 2 times 10 to the 10 centimetres per second. And that tells you that the beam density is about 10 to the 9 per cubic centimetre. And that's greater than or about the density of the corona. So that means that not only are you emptying the corona of all its electrons, but the density of the beam and is the coronal density. So it's not a tenuous beam. It's a beam which is as dense or maybe even denser than the corona. So quite clear what it actually is. And if you calculate the self field is about 10 to the 8 Gauss, which is about a million times higher than the ambient field. So that's obviously not going to work. In plasma physics, what happens then is that a return current must flow. How or where, it's not quite clear. Whether it's actually co-spatial or on a surface or something, it's not clear. But you can write down the equation, the continuity equation, just N beam times V beam is N corona times V return current. So when you do that, work out the return current is a few times 10 to the 9 centimetres per second. So we've got the coronal electrons going in that direction at 10 to the 10 centimetres per second, and an equal density going in that direction at 10 to the 9 centimetres per second, and you think that's going to be stable. The sound speed is about 3 times 10 to the 7 centimetres per second, and the electron thermal speed is about 1.2 times 10 to the 9 centimetres per second. So if you try and force a beam through a plasma greater than the sound speed, then you get the ion acoustic instability. And if you try and do it greater than the thermal speed, you get the Bunneman instability. And these are well-known plasma physics instabilities. The beam is not stable. The beam thermalizes in the corona, and there are several numerical simulations which show this. The beam momentum continues. You can't stop the momentum of the beam, but the energy basically goes into heating. And so the energy propagates on, but then at the thermal speed, not at the beam speed. So this is a problem. This forced us, me and Hugh Hudson primarily, but also it turns out before us, Peter Sturrock and Gordon Emsley, to think about alternatives. And this was motivated by what happens in the ionosphere and magnetosphere during a substorm. And ionospheric and magnetospheric physicists are the luckiest astrophysicists in the world because they can fly through the things that they're examining. Of course, they can fly through the magnetosphere, they can fly through the ionosphere, they can measure the electric fields and the magnetic fields and the densities and all these things we can only infer. And what happens in a magnetospheric substorm is basically that the energy is transferred from the magnetotail to the upper ionosphere by alphane waves. You can measure the polarization of these waves, you can measure their E and B fields, and you can say without any shadow of a doubt that they're alphane waves. The question is then how that alphane wave energy is converted into the kinetic energy of the particles which make the aurora. That's exactly the same question that we have in solar physics. So the general concept then is that before the flare, the energy is going to be stored in the twisted and stretched field. The field reconfigures through reconnection. The loops implode. The twist relaxes and energy is released. And a pulse, a wave pulse of some kind, carries the energy as an MHD pointing flux. And then that wave dissipates in the chromosphere. And there are ways that it can dissipate. For example, ion neutral damping, or you can, if you have a wave moving down into a medium where the alphane speed is changing because it's getting denser, then it will start to reflect, and then you get counter-streaming wave trains, which will rapidly break down into turbulence. What about the numbers there? We've had simple numbers for electrons. We can do simple numbers for this as well. This is, I feel most comfortable thinking about simple numbers. Here's the alphane speed. Here's the alphanic pointing flux. B, this is a difficult one, the coronal magnetic field, but you can get it from gyrosynchrotron emission. And also just estimate it from the properties of a dipole field. You know, if you've got 2 kilogauss here and 2 kilogauss here, and it's separated by 10,000 kilometres, and up here about 5,000 kilometres up or 10,000 kilometres up, it's also about a kilogauss, just from how a dipole field behaves, except this isn't a dipole field, it's twisted, so it can be stronger in the corona. But if you want to do radio observations, you make gyrosynchrotron maps, and you find that about 10,000 kilometres up here is about 500 to a kilogauss above sunspots. And this is a number, again, which we're not used to thinking about in coronal physics. Other measurements give you things more like 15 gauss. But one thing to remember about the coronal magnetic field is how very highly structured it is. There are places where the field is 15 gauss. There are other places where the field is a kilogauss. And it's those places we're interested in. We know the pre-flare coronal density. And that tells us that the alphane speed is about 0.1 to 0.3, the speed of light, which is a bit scary. We're quickly getting into the regime where you have to do relativistic MHD, and I prefer to leave that to the experts. We know the observed chromospheric radiated output, 10 to the 12 Hz per square centimetre, and so you can calculate that all you need to do is twitch the field by about 60 gauss and send that perturbation along the field, and you have enough energy deposited in the chromosphere to make a flare. So that's the two models, which are, I think, now both really viable and in competition. The standard model, where energy release primarily accelerates particles up here, and those particles carry the energy down to the chromosphere. Particles transport energy, dissipation by Coulomb collisions in the chromosphere. Or there's an alternative where energy is released primarily with the effect that MHD waves are launched. And those waves carry the energy along the field and are then dissipated. Now, this dissipation problem has to include electron acceleration in the chromosphere because we see the hard X-rays. We see the non-thermal electrons. But the proposition is that they are accelerated locally in the chromosphere, which has all kinds of difficulties associated with it. So how do we distinguish between these? If we could make X-ray images of the loop, pretty soon we would know whether or not there are beams of electrons, because we would see the bremsstrahlung that they make all the way down. There is a mission flying called RESI, the Ramati High Energy Solar Spectroscopic Imager, and the hope was that RESI would have been able to do that, but it turns out its dynamic range is not good enough. It can only see, it's a Fourier transform telescope, and so you're really bothered by noise there, and you can only see things which are differing in brightness by a factor of no more than maybe 5 or 10, whereas here we're talking maybe a factor of 100 or 1,000. And we can't see that with RESI, but there's a possible successor mission called FOXI, which is not a Fourier transform imager, but a focusing optics X-ray telescope, which might be able to do this. If there are oscillations here, we should be able to see line broadening from the coronal oscillations and also chromospheric oscillations, so spectroscopy might help us. We might also see signatures of different modes of energy deposition in the chromosphere, which I'll talk about, some work that my PhD student, just graduated PhD student, was doing. Actually see the difference about how energy is deposited in the case of waves or in beams. And I think timescales could be discriminatory, because electrons are always fast. Electrons are always going at the speed of electrons when they make a bremsstrahlung emission, 0.1 speed of light, 0.3, and then they stop. So they're either fast or they stop. But waves, as they propagate through this medium with a changing alpha and speed, they will slow down. And so different things will happen at different times. And in fact, it can take a minute for a wave to propagate across the chromosphere. And with DKIST, we're going to be able to see a minute with no problem. So I'll just talk a little bit about the flare modelling that we've been doing. There are different tools. We've been using the code, the RADIN code, which was originally produced by Mats Carlson and Bob Stein. But it's gone through many, many iterations in its life. And now really Joel Allred and Adam Kowalski have taken it over. And this is a radiation hydrodynamics code. So it solves the hydrodynamics of a heated gas, it solves the radiative transfer, the ionization, non-equilibrium ionization, it solves the rate equations, it does shock capturing, it does all the kinds of things you need to be able to examine the dynamics of a strongly heated plasma. But because it can do all of those things, it can only do it in 1D. So it's a 1D code, it's a line. But maybe that's not so bad, because the magnetic field is a very strongly aligning feature, and so maybe all you need to do is look at the dynamics along the field. Hydrad is a similar code, but it's more optimized. It does non-equilibrium ionization of heavier ions. So if you really want to look at the upper atmosphere, where you have to take into account all of the different ionization stages of things like iron and so on, then that's the code for you. Now, there is just some, I don't want to go into the detail of the modelling, because it's actually beyond me. It was Graham Kerr that really went into all this and his thesis. But the general points are that different modes of energy deposition lead to different atmospheric profiles, different density, temperature, velocity and ionization profiles, and different dynamics. The different atmospheres and different dynamics lead to different radiative signatures. And in general, what we want to look at here is optically thick spectral lines, because they retain some information about the velocity profile. It's all lost in optically thin lines because you integrate through this slab of plasma. And the height distribution of the emitting material is important, because the core is formed in a different place from the wings because of the different optical depths in the core and the wings. So you have some velocity information and you have some height information, but the problem is you really have to know your radiative transfer to really interpret it. However, so we ran some models. These are two RADIN simulations of a chromosphere. 10 seconds of heating at 10 to the 11 ergs per square centimetre per second. And the top one is standard RADIN, where there's an electron beam goes in, and there are collisional losses, and you can see the colour is time from 0 to 10 seconds, and so you can see the atmosphere strongly heating. This is a strange feature which occurs because of helium ionisation. Ionisation is very important in a flare chromosphere. But basically what happens here is that at this level in the atmosphere, the hydrogen is ionized, the helium is once ionized at the beginning of the simulation, but very rapidly it becomes twice ionized, and then you run out of atoms which can absorb the energy in a phase transition. And so then all the plasma can do is heat up. So you get this thing that we call the ionization bubble. And that's just there because very strong local deposition and no strong radiative sources to get rid of the energy because everything is ionized now. So this is a feature of a beam model. And this is the Radin run with alphane wave energy deposition. It's an approximation. We use the WKB approximation, which means you're limited in the wavelengths that you can study. We also we don't really have any time evolution of the wave going down through the atmosphere. We have a kind of time average static profile, so that's wrong, but we're working on fixing it. But you can basically see you get a different shape. You do get a lot of heating. The heating is through damping by ion neutral friction predominantly, but also by electron resistivity as well. And you can see there are different profiles. This is height along here from the photosphere down there up to the top of the chromosphere. So you can actually start to, here's the corona, really, it's getting very hot, 10 million Kelvin. And so what does this look like? Well, if you look at magnesium 2, and we've chosen magnesium 2 because it's being observed by the IRIS spacecraft, with which the solar group here have a lot of involvement. And so this is the time profiles for magnesium 2, again, line profiles as a function of time. And with the beam heating, you can see if you look at the top here, it's basically always a centrally reversed profile, a little bit redshifted, but always centrally reversed profile. But the wave heating, it's not. There's a time at the beginning when it's centrally reversed, but very soon it becomes just asymmetric. So there's a clear difference between these two. You can see a difference in a spectral line because of the mode of energy input. So this is just an experiment. We find a more asymmetric magnesium 2 K line profile, no central reversal. But pleasingly, the wave heating results are more similar to the flare observation than the beam heating results. Here is a detail of the profile, and you can see it's somewhat redshifted, and there's no central reversal. So we're quite optimistic about this. Here's the elephant in the room. What about the electrons? We know that there are electrons. We know that hard X-rays are observed from the flare chromosphere. So in the wave transport picture, electrons have to be accelerated there. The pre-flare chromosphere is dense, it's cool, and it's collisional. How do you accelerate particles there? Well, there's a couple of options. First of all, you heat it. So it becomes collisionless, and then you can accelerate the particles, which are in the collisionless tail of the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Or, well, you know, the atmosphere accelerates particles, gamma ray flashes from lightning. I don't know how it does it, but it does it. Aurora as well. You can get X-ray aurora in planets and in atmospheres which are much denser and much cooler than the flare chromosphere. So don't know how it does it, but it's not implausible to think that, you know, you've got a rapidly changing magnetic field, a non-ideal plasma, you could get a parallel electric field as well, which might be able to do this. Okay, I have a few minutes left, so let me just say a little bit about flares on sun-like stars, because there's probably some interest here. In fact, probably people know more about it than I do. Thousands of flares on sun-like stars have been observed with Kepler. So by sun-like, I'm meaning G-type stars in rotation periods of greater than 10 days. And so there's an example of one there, which is zoomed in here. This is in flux. Okay, it's not in those horrible astronomical magnitude type units, which I hate, and I hate colours even more than I hate magnitudes. And so these are factors of a few enhancements from a star as a star observation. And here is a factor of, well, you know, it's like 0.3% enhancement or something like that. So these are colossal. The ones that you can observe, of course, the ones you can detect are colossal in flares compared to solar flares. They look solar-like, but you detect much larger total energies. in the optical. You can get down to, you know, maybe 10 times the energy of the biggest flare we have. You know, the two ranges are meeting now in the middle with some careful detection. But in some of these objects, if you look at the background light curve, it's very different from a solar light curve. On this scale of, you know, tens of days, the solar light curve would be pretty flat. There are excursions because of spots moving, but it's really nothing like this. It's nothing like this. So it might be that some of these solar type stars have just got a very different spot configuration than the Sun. So you have to be careful about drawing analogies. What about super flares on the Sun? The question on everybody's lips. So here's the flare distribution made up from lots of different data types, nanoflares, so-called nanoflares, the very smallest events, 10 to the 40, 24 or so, microflares, then ordinary solar flares and hard X-rays. And they're all different, you know, because these slopes depend on the wavelength that you're looking at and the biases in assembling the statistical distribution. But basically, they follow a fairly good straight line. And the biggest flare we have so far is like this. It's about here. It's like 10 to the 33 ergs or something. If you take the super flares from solar-type stars and plot them on this diagram, they come out here, actually, on the same line, pretty much. This is an upper limit here, I think. And if you were to extrapolate, then it would tell you that a super flare would occur about once every 500 years, so something which is 10 or 100 times bigger than the biggest flare we've had. But again, we have this caveat that these very active stars may be a different magnetic paradigm from the solar case. Is there evidence for super flares in the past? Possibly. So one of the things that flares do is accelerate protons to high energies, and that leads to variations in isotopic abundances. And you can see those variations in isotopic abundances if you look in tree rings and in ice cores. And this is tree ring data. This is what you might call heliodendrochronology. I didn't make that name up. That was my husband made that name up. Hugh Hudson made that name up. Heliodendrochronology. And this is carbon-14 variations in tree ring data. This is I think this is per mil or something, I'm not quite sure. Again, superposed. No, it's not superposed. This is just from these three types of trees. There's two events in which this has been seen. So the larch, the bristlecone pine, and another kind of tree, I don't know what it was that Miyake was looking at. And these are basically sampled annually because you can't do much better with tree ring data. And you see this rapid rise, this rapid change in the carbon-14. And it's been speculated this event and another one like it in 993 AD was because of an enormous solar flare which accelerated protons, and those protons changed the isotopic composition of the atmosphere, and then the atmospheric circulation, it takes a while or so, it takes a year or something for that actually to manifest in the carbon content of a tree, but this is possibly what we were seeing here. However, there's always however, isn't there? The 1859 flare, probably the most geo-effective flare on record based on the aurora and geomagnetic reports and so on, but it left absolutely no detectable isotopic disturbances in the trees, which you can go back to 1859 and you can examine. So these might indicate something very much bigger, these super flares. And you know, this is on everybody's mind right now, M-star flares. M-stars are far more numerous than solar-type stars, and flares on M-type stars are far more powerful than these solar-type flares. And Adam Kowalski, who's just got a faculty position at UC Boulder, did his thesis on this with Suzanne Hawley and has done a lot of nice work on dwarf M-star flare modelling with the Radin code. And, you know, the importance, of course, is that the ultraviolet can change the atmospheric chemistry. And so the strong bursts of ultraviolet and repeated bursts of ultraviolet, then it could really change the atmosphere of any planets in the habitable zone and also compress the magnetosphere and drive erosion. So if you're thinking about habitable zones around an M-dwarf, you have to think carefully about the flaring activity and whether it is in fact a habitable zone at all. There is my summary. So I hope that I've managed to convince you that solar flares are essentially magnetic phenomena. The atmosphere does what it has to do to get rid of that energy which has been liberated by the changing magnetic field. Some of that is particle acceleration. Some of that is the CME, which I didn't talk about at all. But all of these things are intimately related to the rapid reconfiguration of the magnetic field. The standard model of coronal storage and release by reconnection is a good framework for the flare phenomenon overall, but analogies with the aurora and long-standing concerns about the viability of the required strong electron beams in the standard model are stimulating development of wave transport models. And I think that now we have the tools, that both the observational tools, which will be enhanced with DKIST, and the theoretical tools to really put competing models of storage transport, actually just the transport and dissipation part, to the test. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have time for questions. Well, I will start off with one. So the paper that I am familiar with the number problem from our Swiss colleague, are there other events than that paper that have been sufficiently well observed to have a number problem, or is it kind of all tied to that well observed event?
I would say
event?
that's the best characterized one, because it had a particular kind of RESI imaging. It had the finest resolution imaging, the grid one imaging, and the optical imaging, and being able to put those two on top of each other really said the optical part of the spectrum, which we can measure very well, is where the hard X-rays come from. However, I wrote a paper in 2007 where I had a sample of 9 M-class and X-class flares with white light imaging and X-rays as well, and we basically came to the same conclusion. But Sam really, it was really nice to see somebody other than me banging on about this, because Sam came to the same conclusion with an independent flare and his own analysis. Yeah. So it's not all hanging on Sam's analysis, but it's, I think that's probably the best constrained case.
The alpha waves will tend to reflect when they go into this region where the speed is changing so much. Where does that happen?
Well, they depends on your atmospheric density distribution. I'm trying to think. So I did some calculations with, or Alex Russell did some calculations, helped by the EADs and abetted by me, to calculate the reflection and transmission coefficients of alpha waves going into a chromosphere. And we discovered that you could get, I can't tell you exactly where it happens, but because I can't remember, it's in the paper somewhere, but we worked out how much could get through, and about, depending on the wavelength, you can get about, you know, 30-40% of the energy right down deep into the atmosphere, but the rest reflects and presumably goes back along the magnetic field to the other foot point, where some of it will get through. But then you have to think about the dynamics of the process. We just did a linear model where the wave energy deposition didn't affect the atmosphere that it was going into. But of course, as soon as you start to heat the atmosphere, it starts to heat and expand, and so the density gradients decrease, and so the alpha speed gradients decrease, and so more of the energy will go in next time round. So I'm afraid I can't answer off the top of my head exactly where in the chromosphere it happens, but you can get enough wave energy through the chromosphere to make this a viable process.
I have a question regarding the long-term evolution of the solar activity. Right? Mm-hmm. If you consider all the time it's been sitting on the main sequence and it will be sitting for the next couple of billion years, several billion years, will it ever calm down, or will it more or less constantly active at the level we have now for the next billion years until it leaves the main sequence?
I'm sure there are people in this room who can answer this question better than me. My weak understanding of this is that the level of activity as measured by things like the X-ray corona is related to the rotation rate up to a point. After a certain rotation speed, the whole thing saturates and the activity is
gets, or at least the X-ray corona doesn't get any brighter. And so faster rotators are generally more active, is my understanding. Right? I think so. And so is this, yeah.
I don't think we expect it. Yeah. The things that are generating the field aren't changing on those time scales.
Yeah, but so, I mean, by implication, I guess, this
the
starts to slow
down. The convection and rotation
down,
are the two things you need, right?
So convection and rotation. So if the sun starts to slow down, then presumably its activity will decrease. If the convection zone moves,
yeah,
but so basically, it won't slow down until it leaves the main sequence.
Yes, okay. I think it won't. Yeah. The drivers are the drivers for the next million years or so.
Yeah, but, I mean, there's nobody understands the solar dynamo. Right. None but one. So you can't. they can reproduce the solar dynamo, but without actually understanding it, they can reproduce it in simulations. And you know, this is fantastic work. Even to be able to reproduce it means you're doing something, right? But you know, you, in other words, you can reproduce the pattern of spots and the subsurface flows and all of these things. But whether that has any predictive capability to look not on millions or billions of years, but on, you know, tens or decades, and you know, that's not quite clear yet whether it has any predictive capability. I don't think we need to worry for any reasonable time yet.
You praise the optically thick lines, and they do have certain advantages, but they have disadvantages. How about the optically thin lines, or the effectively optically thin lines? Haven't we learned something about that, about the dynamics of the high temperature plasma?
Yes, yeah, you're absolutely right, we have, and I didn't cover that at all. Yeah. But from the optically thin lines, such as we see with iris and with ice, we see evaporation velocity, we see flows, we can do density diagnostics, we can do temperature diagnostics, we can do look at compositions. I mean, we can do an amazing amount with the optically thin lines. But the reason that I've focused on the optically thick lines for this problem is that, again, it was Alex Russell working together with Jeff Reap, but I forget where Jeff is now, NRL, I think, did a similar test to what Graham and I did with the optically thick lines. They looked at the optically thin lines and what would a wave model look like and an electron beam model look like for the optically thin lines. And you couldn't tell them apart. There was no discriminating power then, because basically all, you know, the optically thin lines are coming from the heated upper chromosphere. And you know, all it can do is radiate as much as it can. Conduction smears any temperature profile very rapidly. You integrate through an enormous amount of plasma, and a lot of the information is just smooth. So we learn a lot about plasma properties, but I'm not so convinced that we'll be able to discriminate between these two heating modes.
Yeah,
that makes sense. I love optically thin lines. They're easier, easier than optically thick lines, but I don't think that they contain quite the same information.
Yeah, about the FOXY and the hard X-ray, I thought the FOXY only goes up to some soft X-ray. And regarding that, the follow-up question is, what kind of resolution actually do you need to resolve one of those hard X-ray coming from the flux lines?
Yeah.
I probably missed the
Okay, so yeah, FOXY, I mean, it's a focusing optics instrument, so it has to be made of a high Z material, and even then I think you can only get up to about 40 kV, I think this is the number I remember, about 40 kV. And so, you know, there we are not completely in the thermal part of the spectrum. I love that elephant. I'm very happy when I found that shouty elephant there. So I'm trying to find a spectrum. So, you know, here's thermal, and the break between thermal and non-thermal happens around here, about 15 kV. So FOXY should be able to see out to about here. So we should be able to get a lot of non-thermal emission here. For resolution, it's not so much the spatial resolution that is a challenge, because you know, if you look at something even with RESI's resolution here, you can certainly distinguish something in the corona, but this is soft X-rays in the corona, you can certainly distinguish something in the corona from something down here. It's what I mentioned before, the dynamic range, the ability to see bright things and faint things at the same time. And the Fourier transform imagers just don't have that dynamic range. The time available, the integration time available, we need focusing optics to beat down the background and be able to achieve the higher dynamic range.
In the case of New Star, mm-hmm. it has about arithmetic resolution. Mm-hmm. I'm guessing that may not be enough for resolving those.
Yeah, so in fact, there is quite a lot of work going on with New Star solar studies, and one of our research fellows, Ian Hanna in Glasgow, is involved in some of that. And my understanding of New Star is that it's so sensitive, because it's not designed for the sun, it's so sensitive that it saturates very, very quickly, and you can only look at really faint things. You can't look at a flare, you can only look at a tiny, weak, pathetic active region.
But they're still looking for the non-thermal signatures. Are they sort of a characteristic feature of plasma?
I don't think that they've really found convincing evidence of non-thermals in non-flaring active regions, or even anything that looks like, you know, suprathermals. I don't think they've seen anything.
New Star was one of our great abilities to demonstrate we can't forecast flares, because we had a New Star campaign, and it turned out it was one of the major flares of the solar cycle. But we thought there was going to be double flares.
Yeah, I did have a slide here about forecasting solar flares, but there's nothing you can say. We can't do it. The best forecast we have of solar flares is there will be no solar flare today. That's the best forecast. Statistically, you know, by truth test, that's the best forecast.
So are you saying the arc-minute resolution is sort of good enough, as long as you can...
No, arc-minute, I think, would be good enough. I mean, this is... That's 20 arc seconds. So that's not going to be. You can see that. You can see on the wall. So you need something with RESI equivalent spatial resolution, which was a couple of arc seconds when it was doing its job properly. But really, it's the dynamic range which is going to be the more important thing, which you need the focusing optics for.
Okay.